Welcome in the fourth lecture devoted to wave and optics. So in this lecture we are going to first introduce what we call wave fronts. We will need these in order to explain Doppler effect and shock waves. And before that, we will also talk about power and intensity of a wave and introduce the concept of point source. And also for sound, we will explain the decibel unit. So as usual, we use this is our reference book. You may have a look also to John Colley and to this free ebook available on the internet. First, let's define wave fronts of a plane wave. So wave fronts are surfaces over which the oscillation due to the wave have the same value. So taking this example here, so the wave have the same value, it means that y always have the same value. So it means that the phase always have the same value. Okay. So you can, for example, you can, so usually we take a maximum. So for a sine wave like this, we take the maxima here. And so we draw the lines of, or the surfaces of constant value for y, which correspond to constant value of the phase. So in this particular case, it is for sine equal 1, which would be, in fact, it's not because this, okay. If n equals 0, you have 1, but n equal 1, you would have minus 1. So there is a slight mistake here. It should be a 2n plus a half in order to have this one, because this, the minus 1 is not considered. Okay. It's only the plus one here that are the wave fronts. So this is a case in 2D. So in that case, the wave fronts are lines, like in this case. For one dimensional, of course, it would just be points because you would just look at one. In 1D, you would just have this curve. So it would be just that dot, that point, that point, that point. In 3D, it will be surfaces, okay, of identical phases. So we also define rays. So rays are directed lines perpendicular to the wave fronts that indicate the direction of travel of the wave fronts. So we won't use this concept of rays with a sound or with a string, but it will be useful in optics. Okay. Also notice that the distance in space between two wave fronts is of course one wavelength. It's one period in space. All right. So I will correct maybe here if I can. No, it won't work. Here we represent plane waves and their wave fronts. So a plane wave in fact can be represented by this this equation that we have used so far. You see that in this equation it just does not depend on y and z. Therefore, all the values are the same in the YZ plane. Therefore, our plane waves, for a plane wave, actually, it makes sense, the wave fronts are just planes. Okay, like was shown here. All right, and a top view of these is shown here. So these are the wave fronts shown from the side or from the top. Okay. And okay, distance between each wave front is lambda, so two consecutive wave fronts. We have, of course, lambda equal vt. V is a property of the medium. So one interesting thing that we will see that mostly in optics, that lambda and therefore k equal 2 pi over lambda, depends on the medium. So looking at this equation, we have omega and k. K depends on the medium, but omega does not. Okay. So we'll discuss this in the next slide. So the explanation of the fact that the frequency stays the same at the boundary between two media is explained here. So it happens when you have really a boundary and two media. And the frequency of the incident wave is the same as the frequency of the transmitted wave. So this is the important fact. For example, if you have two persons, you can say that they are two different media. And if you have like the human wave in a stadium, like the movie we have shown in the first in the second lecture, when one person oscillate with his hand, and they hold the hands together, so it's like a handshake. Okay, the other one, if one medium oscillates at a given frequency, the other one has to oscillate at the same frequency, even if it has different properties. Okay, so it's also known as the handshake principle. So please read this. So the change of wavelengths when we cross from a medium, let's say one, to medium two, is shown on this graph. So this is medium one, you have lambda one, lambda equal Vt. So V is a property of that medium, the speed. And in this medium, the speed may be different. So in that case, you have, because T stays the same, okay, the frequency stays the same, therefore T stays the same. And if lambda is smaller here, it's because your velocity in medium 2 is lower than in medium 1. So these represent wavefronts, these ones, and this is the ray. Here we have an example of wavefronts in two dimensions. So these are the maxima. Okay, so the maximum shown here. So these are known as the crest. And the minima, sometimes they are also useful. So it's in between, so the halfway between two white lines. This is the minimum. And this is called a trough. So this drawing shows the same thing. So these are the wavefronts for a point source in blue, and at a given position, you may have to look at a given position, let's say a distance r from the source. So this is the orange circle here, and the wave goes through perpendicularly to this circle. So the rays in the case of a point source, the rays are just radial. They are perpendicular to the wavefronts. And this is an animation showing the emission of the wave. Because this is a snapshot at a given time, we take a picture. But as a function of time, this is happening. Of course, the wave is propagating radially away from the source. Let's introduce here the intensity of a wave. So in fact, it is the average power at which the energy is transported. So it is usually we represent the intensity by a capital I here. So it is a flux of energy. So the unit is a joule per second per square meter. Okay, so a flux is something going through a surface area, so it's per square meter and per second, per unit time. So in this case, it is a flux of energy. So we have joule in front of per second and per square meter. So it is an energy. Let's consider, for example, this element of surface. See, so it has an area A, and the wave is crossing that area. So it will have so the total energy actually crossing this area would be I multiplied by A, because so it would be a joule per second, the total energy crossing this area. So the flux multiplied, so I multiplied by A. Okay. So this is per square meter. So if you multiply by A, which is in square meter, you will get a flux in joule per second. So for a string, we get this equation. So the demonstration is in your book. For sound, you would get this one or this one. So why two different versions? It's because we have seen that sound can be described by a wave of displacements. So this describes the maximum displacement. And or you can use the pressure. So this is the amplitude of the pressure. So for a string, you have just the amplitude of the string. Okay. All right. So we will see in optics also the intensity of an electromagnetic wave. So I will derive the flux of energy only in the case of an electromagnetic wave, and not here for the string or for the sound. You can watch that in your book, and the process is exactly the same, so we will do it only for one type of wave. So here, mu and rho are actually the same thing. It is a mass density. Just we use rho in general for a gas, and mu for solid. And v is the wave speed. So what is in blue here is in fact a medium property. Okay. And what is in red here is a wave, our wave variables. So when you create your wave, you have a given amplitude, ym, and a given frequency, angular frequency, omega. So these are not properties of the material itself, of the medium, but when you create your wave. Okay. So for all types of wave, you have the intensity is proportional to the square of these variables, wave variables. And usually you must have also the properties of the medium. So you will have, and in general you have a half here. So this could be included in the material property. But in general, you have the intensity is half of material, so medium properties multiplied by some variable square. So you can actually, it's like the energy, you know, the energy half of mv squared, half of kx squared for a spring. So it's very similar. Because this is energy, it's an energy flow per second. So it's very close to be an energy. It's just an energy flowing per second. So it's quite natural to see this relationship between the intensity and the energy. So we have just defined the intensity, which is a flux of energy. So it is in joule per second per square meter. Let's here consider a point source, which emit at power P S for source in joule per second. So that one. So it is emitting isotropic. Its emission is isotropic in three dimensions here. So because of conservation of energy, that energy that is generated at point S will be found at any distance from S. So for example, if you consider that distance R, at this distance, the intensity will be the same, but the power, if you integrate over the whole surface, all the energy that is crossing this this line or this sphere in three dimensions will be equal to S. Okay. So in fact, what I said is illustrated by this equation, because the power is the energy is conserved. The energy crossing any of this of any sphere here at any distance from the source must be the same. So you can express that power by the intensity multiplied by the area that you are considering. Okay, so from the point of view of units, it is consistent. You have joule per second for the power, joule per second and per square meter for the intensity, and the area is in square meter. So you can write your intensity as the total emitted power by your point source divided by the area, which must be perpendicular to the flow direction. So in our case, it will always be the case. For example, here for the emission is isotropic, so the energy is just flowing radially. Okay, so for example here at this point, the energy is flowing perpendicularly to the tangent. Alright, so we will talk more about fluxes when we study Maxwell's equation, and I'm sure you have studied some fluxes, like the flux of the electric field in FP3. So you have an idea of what that means. Alright, so in this particular case, for a point source, what is the area? So if we consider a distance r, it is the area of that sphere in orange. So this of course is just a cross section. So the area is for a sphere is 4 pi r squared. Therefore, your intensity at distance r is given by this. Let's take an example. So we have here a point source. Here, emits waves, isotropic emission, at a constant power. At r equal r0, here, as we know the intensity, it is I0. So what is the intensity I1 at r equal r1 as a function of the other parameters? Okay, so what do we use here? We use conservation of energy or conservation of energy flow. So let's say that P of r0 is the power is all the energy crossing that sphere of radius r0. So all that energy must be crossing also the sphere of radius r1. So we have P of r0 equal P of r1. So now we can express these as a function of I and r. Because the power is equal to the intensity by the area for a given R. So for the first one, for R1 we have this, and for R0 this. So we can just take the ratio. Okay, so the ratio is 1 because this is conserved. We have I1 divided by I0 and these are the areas, 4 pi R squared. For both radii. So in the end, you have I1 equals call I0 multiplied by I0 divided by R1. So this is a nice, beautiful equation because you have an intensity, another intensity, and a ratio of something that that is a dimension less because these two quantities have the same unit. Okay, so you see here clearly that that I1 will be much lower than I0 because R1 is higher than R0. All right, so let's talk about the decibel scale. So this is another unit for intensity, especially used in for sound. So let's see, humans can hear over a very large range of intensities, 10 to the 12. So that's a pretty big number. So it's quite difficult to manipulate because, okay, have you ever manipulated something from 0 to 10 to the 12? So that's not easy. So the decibel scale uses a log base 10 scale. So it uses y equal log x. So in this case, so log is often used to reduce the range of variation. So if you multiply x by 10, then y increases only by 1. Okay. So so decibel is this. So it's a log of the intensity divided by a reference intensity that we will define soon and multiply by 10 for convenience. Okay, so in this case, if I is multiplied by 10, beta is multiplied by 10 because of this this 10 here. So this reduces, transforms in some sense the range of 10 to the 12 into a range of just 120. So your intensity now will range from 0 to 120. So this is easy to manipulate. So dB is the abbreviation for decibel. And I0, so we have to choose a value. It's kind of arbitrary, but a good choice is, of course, the lower limit of human range of hearing. Okay, below that you don't hear, so you don't need to measure the intensity. All right, so and in our case, so it's 10 to the minus 12 watt per square meter. So watt is joule per second. So this is indeed an intensity. All right, so and you can check actually that if you take I equal I zero, the log is 1, and therefore your beta is 0. Okay. So this is our reference level. All right, so these are some examples of intensities. So this is the sound level in decibel, in dB. So from 0 to here 160, and the corresponding intensity. So you can see that so every time we increase, we multiply by 10, we just add 10 in this case. All right, so zero threshold, okay. So 120 is a loud rock concert. Threshold of pain. After that, you experience some pain. But actually, the damage occurs before that. Here, 110 is damage from 30 minutes per day exposure. Okay. So that's why in some factories, etc., some people, they wear some special thing on the ears in order to protect their ears. Okay. The ear is not equally sensitive to all frequencies. As you know, if you listen to music, for example, you probably sometimes use an equalizer. So where you can choose the intensity of different frequencies when you listen to music. If you like bass, for example, you will increase the intensity of the low frequency range. If you are okay, this is called the trebles, high frequency, and the bass. So this shows the response in some sense of our ear. It's a detector. Our ear is a detector, so it can detect the sound in only from around what 20, 30 hertz to above 10, 20,000 hertz. So this is above that we don't hear. So it is ultrasound. We don't hear that. We don't hear below below let's say 20 hertz. This changes with the age. As we age, this range decreases. It becomes narrower. Okay, so these curves show to hear the same loudness for sounds of different frequencies, different intensities are required. So this means that around this is 1,000, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 is here, so 4, 3. Around 4,500 is the frequency for which our ear is the most sensitive. We need only a very low, low intensity is enough to hear something. If you want to hear, to have the same loudness with a frequency of let's say 50, you need to have a much higher intensity. Okay. So this is because our ear is a detector, and this works also for the eye, for any kind of detectors. For example, let's make a small drawing here. So for example, the intensity that you detect with your detector is equal to the intensity that is entering into your detector. So let's say emitted by some source, emitted, multiplied by the response of your detector. So let's call it D, response of your detector. And this will depend on the energy. Okay, so the emission is also can depend on the energy, and your response, the response of your detector depends on the energy. So in fact, this here in the case of this our ear, it would be these curves shown here, but upside down in a way. They would be they would have this kind of, so if you plot D as a function of energy, you would have something like that. Okay, and this would be, so energy, frequency is can also be a measure of energy. So let's say this is 20 hertz, and here about 20,000, so kilo hertz. Okay, so this would be the response of your ear. Okay, so 0 below 20, 0 above 20,000. And this is the same for actually for our eye. So our eye detects visible light. So for light, this would be the maximum would be, so we will see that in when we study optics, 500 nanometer for the wavelengths, and this would be around 400 nanometer. So it is the opposite. The energy and the wavelengths are in the opposite direction, and this is around 800 nanometer. So you could convert that into energies. Okay. So and this would be the UV. and this would be the infrared. Okay. So this concept, this kind of equation is general for any kind of detector. Okay, what you detect is what enters the detector multiplied by the response of the detector. Now we are going to study the Doppler effect. So Doppler was an Austrian, and he discovered this phenomenon in 1842. So the question is, what is the frequency detected by D, for example here, if D and or S, the source, are moving with respect to the air? So that is the question. So just to clear the problem of the wind, let's see the two situations shown here. So situation one, there is wind, so the air mass is moving, whereas S and D are stationary. Situation two, S and D are moving at the same speed with respect to the air. So let's say the air is not moving and S and D are moving at some given velocity. So but the same as the velocity of the wind in this case. Yeah. So these two situations are identical. So you can convince yourself. So the important thing is the speed of S and D with respect to the air. So this will, when we talk about VD or VS, speed of the source, speed of the detector, it will be with respect to the air. So if there is some wind, you should do a transformation such that your VS and VD are speeds taken with respect to the air. So this is an animation to illustrate the Doppler effect. You may visit this link if you want to play with that animation. Let's look at an animation for the Doppler shift. So here we have a source here, and this is a detector. So we start the emission from the source here, and this graph will show you the waves as emitted from the source, and this one the waves as detected by the observer. So we start, and these are the wavefronts that propagates. So the emitted wave is identical to the detected wave. Okay, when both are stationary. So now let's see what happens when the detector is moving away from the source. Right. So you see that. Okay. I will pause. Okay, so the emission is this, and you see that the detection is different. So the wavelength that of the detector is longer than the wavelength of the source. Or in this case, we can talking about frequencies. So because this axis is time, so we see that the frequency as detected by the observer is lower than the frequency of the source. Alright, so let's do the same thing, but now when the observer will get closer to the source. Alright, so now the observer is going towards the source, and we see that in this case the frequency is higher for the observer. Okay, clearly it is. So I suppose that each peak here corresponds to the situation when the observer crosses one wavefront, because these are the maxima. We can see that again. Yeah, the maxima corresponds to when wavefronts are crossing the observer. Alright, so indeed, when the observer is going away from the source, you have a lower frequency as detected by the observer, and when it goes towards the source, it has, you can, the observer feels a higher frequency, and it makes sense because it goes towards the wavefronts that are coming towards it. So let's start with a situation where there is no Doppler effect, just to show you the method that we are going to use to find out the frequency when there is Doppler effect. So we start with a stationary source and a stationary detector. They do not move. So what is the frequency detected by the detector D? So our detector is here, it doesn't move. And there is a sound wave coming at it, towards it, in this way. So these are wavefronts, so separated by wavelengths lambda in space, like that. And v is the speed of that wave. So in time t, let's consider a time t. So the wavefronts move to the right a distance vt. Alright, so all these wavefronts will cross. So if this distance is Vt, all these wavefronts will cross the detector. Alright, so these wavefronts at time t equals 0 are now here. Okay, so they all crossed the ear. So to get the frequency, we need to get the number of wavelengths intercept that has passed through the detector. So the number of wavelengths lambda in that distance Vt is the number of wavelengths intercepted by D in time t, which is therefore this distance divided by lambda, Vt divided by lambda. So the rate at which D intercepts the wavelengths is the frequency detected by D. Therefore, we have to divide this by T. Right? Because frequency is a number per second. Okay. A number of wavelengths intercepted by the ear per second. So therefore, so the Vt disappears with Vt, so we have V divided by lambda, and which is just 1 divided by the period. Okay. By definition, the V is lambda divided by T, therefore we find that the frequency is 1 divided by the period, which is the definition, in fact, of the frequency. Okay, so there is no Doppler effect in this case, which is normal because the detector is stationary and the source is also stationary. But this is to show you the method that we are going to use. In order to get a frequency, we can look at the number of wavelengths intercepted by the ear in some given time. So let's now look at the situation where S, the source S, is stationary and the detector D is moving towards S. Okay, and we would like to find the frequency detected by the detector D. All right, so we have to look at time T and look at how many wavefronts cross the detector in that time t. So in that time t, we can draw these wavefronts. We know that all these wavefronts will cross the detector. So what is that length? So of course you have the wavefronts moving to the right a distance vt. Okay, the wave is moving at speed v. So these wavefronts will have moved a distance vt, which is this distance. D is also moving towards the source. So D moves to the left distance v dt. Okay, it has a speed v dt. So you can see that all these wavefronts in time t will have crossed the detector. Okay. And this length, the total length, will be vt plus vdt. So what we want is how many wavelengths we have in this length, which is just vt plus vdt divided by lambda. And if we want the frequency, we just have to divide. So the frequency is in fact how many wavefronts have crossed d per unit time. So we know that number of wavelengths have crossed d, so we need to divide by the time it took for all these wavefronts to pass through d, which is t. So we just divide by t. Okay, so we get this. So the t again disappear and we have this. So here we still have lambda. Lambda can be expressed as a function of the speed and the frequency of the source. Like this. So in the end, we get that f prime, which is the frequency as detected by the detector, is equal to the frequency as emitted by the source with a correction, which is V plus Vd divided by V. So this is the equation for the Doppler effect when you have a stationary source and a detector D moving towards S. So now we are looking at a stationary source S and the detector D moving away from S. And we want to find the frequency detected by detector D. So in fact, the situation is very similar to what we have just done. The only difference will be in the sign of this Vt and Vdt. So now we have a minus instead of a plus. All right, and we will get in the end this frequency with V minus Vd divided by V. Let's now look at the situation where D is stationary. So we put D here and it's not moving. And S is moving towards D. So S is here and it's moving towards D. Alright, so at let's say at t equals 0, our source is here and it has a maximum in its wave. So we have a wavefront created here. We call it W1. Let's look after a time t, so one period. So that wavefront has moved by a distance vt. V is the speed of sound. So now that wavefront is here. And because the period, the time is now one period away from here, another wavefront is generated. So we call it W2 at the place of where the source is. And this distance is Vst. So this S is the speed of the source. So now you see that the detector will receive some wavefronts, which distance the distance between each consecutive wavefront is this. So this is the wavelength that the detector will feel, will receive. Okay, so this wavelength is in fact equal to this distance, so Vt, minus this distance, which is Vst. So the wavelength of that wave is V minus Vst. Alright, so we can get actually directly the frequency using the usual equation, which is F equal V divided by the wavelength. So F prime is again the frequency detected by D. So we replace lambda prime here by this expression. And then we get rid of the T, we replace that by F, because T equal 1 divided by F. So in the end, we get that F prime equal F of the source by speed of the sound divided by speed of the sound minus speed of the source. Let's now look at the case where S is moving away from D, and D is stationary. So D is here, not moving, and S is here and moving away. So in fact, this is a kind of opposite situation as that we have seen in the previous slide. In the previous slide, we were here. The fixed detector was on this side and receiving these wavefronts. Okay, and these wavefronts have a given distance, which was I think Vt minus Vst. Okay, so now it is the opposite. On this side, you see that the distance between consecutive wavefronts, which is a new wavelength, is in fact Vt plus Vst. Okay, so it's easy to see. So in the same way, we can get the frequency detected by D in this way. So you see the only difference is just this sign. So this is a summary, and it shows the general Doppler formula. So F prime is the frequency detected by the detector and F emitted by the source. V is the speed of sound through the air, and Vd and Vs are the detector's speed relative to the air and the source speed relative to the air. Alright, so notice that so there is plus or minus. You do not need to memorize which situation correspond to which sign. It just makes sense, and in particular when for motion towards, so when the source, let's say, is moving towards D, obviously D will intercept more wavefronts than in a normal without motion at all. So the frequency will be greater. Okay. And when let's say D is moving away, it will intercept less wavefronts per second, and therefore F prime will be lower than F. So, and this works always. So for both the numerator and the denominator. So for example, if you have D moving towards, so towards the source, you need to maximize F prime. Okay, so maximize F prime, you put a plus. Okay. Now the source. Let's say the source is moving towards the detector. So again, you need to maximize f prime. So how can you maximize with the denominator, with this denominator? You put a minus. Okay. And okay, the opposite for less. So the next slide will show you which signs to take. Notice a particular case here. If the source is supersonic, that is, it is going at a speed that is greater than the speed of sound. So you know that some planes, for example, can go, even I think some humans manage to go faster than the speed of sound. So in this case, this function would not work when S is moving towards D. Because in such a case, you would have a V minus Vs, and you would find a frequency that is negative, which doesn't make sense. Okay, so in this particular case, we are going to look to need another treatment. Okay. Okay, so here I just write again the formula with the signs. So the minus sign when D is moving away from S, otherwise it's a plus sign when S is moving away from D, otherwise minus sign. So you don't need again to memorize, just use the trick that it should be maximum when they are relatively getting closer to from each other, S and D, or it should decrease when they are going away from each other. Alright, so me, I didn't like this when I saw that for the first time. I say why we have to choose some plus minus. All of these are taken positive numbers, so V, VD, VS, V. So I came up with a function that is shown here. So I've never seen this in any anywhere. So, but it looks like it works. If you take, so in that case, you need to take the speed of the wave from S to D. So you take vectors in this case. Okay, so it's all is algebraic, and you take the speed of the phase from S to D. So please tell me if there is some problem with that formula, if you are interested. Anyway, for official purposes, you use this formula. Okay, so this is just okay, just for play. If you, I think it looks like it works. So please let me know if you find any problem with that formula. Let's see now what happens when an object is moving at the speed of sound and emitting some sound. So here, for example, you have an object that not moving. So this is an animation showing the emission of the wave fronts. So let's say this each circle here represent a maximum in the pressure of the air. So this would be a snapshot. And the distance between each wave front is one wavelength. So now the object is moving here in B, but still at a speed lower than the speed of sound. So this is similar to what we've discussed with the Doppler effect. You have accumulation, the distance between wave fronts in front of the object is become smaller than the original wavelength. So this distance is smaller than this one. And on the contrary, in the direction behind that moving object, the wavelength is longer than this reference wavelength. So for example, an observer here would feel a higher frequency than the original frequency, and an observer here would feel a lower frequency than the original frequency. Okay. So this is the corresponding animation, so you see the object moving, etc. Alright, so in this situation you have the object is going exactly at the speed of sound. So you can see it in this animation. When it emits a new wavefront, that wavefront is going at the same speed as the object. Therefore, it always stays just at the same position as the object. Okay. So this is a snapshot of this situation. And you see that all these wavefronts accumulate in front of the object. So imagine what this means for the object here just in front. Because each wavefront is a maximum, let's say, of the wave. Okay, so for example, you have one wave like this coming from this wavefront. Okay, and you have the same wave coming from the second wavefront, from this one. Okay, and then another from this one. You would again have a wavefront like this, and again from the other one. So, and this position here is one of the maxima. And so you understand that this is an interference pattern. At this point, you just add all the waves. So in the case here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a 4. Okay. So here you just have one. Here in this, let's say if you look at this direction, you have one here. But here all the ones, all the maxima, are in at the same point in space, and they keep. They stay there as a function of time, so they keep on accumulating. So if you just stay at the speed of sound forever, these diverge. You would have a huge pressure building up at the front of the object. So you understand why it is extremely difficult to pass that barrier, the so-called sound barrier. Okay, because when you are at the speed of sound, you have so much pressure accumulating at the front of the plane, let's say, of the object or the object, that usually the earlier attempts to pass the speed of sound with a plane resulted in the destruction of the plane. Okay, because this was inducing some huge pressure variations around the plane, and it was destroying the plane. Okay, so indeed you have constructive interference of waves at the object front side. So, and this is called a sound barrier. Alright, so now let's see. So this is again the case where the speed of the source is the same as the speed of sound, and this is the case when the source is going faster than the sound. So now you have this this animation shows what you would get. So it is the object is going faster than the sound, so the sound is already behind it. Okay, so we have the formation of a kind of cone. Okay, shown here. So let's say at t equals 0, you have the source was here at position S1, and it emitted a wavefront called W1. And later on, after time t, that source has emitted 6. So t is in fact equal to 6 periods. So it has emitted 6. Wavefronts. Well, it's more than that because the wavefront has already traveled, so it's not 6 periods. But at position 6, you have a 6th wavefront there. Okay. Okay, so the first one is here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, and you have this the formation of this this kind of cone, and this is called actually the Mach cone. So look at what is here. So let's look probably at the next slide. You see that. So it's explained in this text. You see that at along this line, so the cone along the cone. Because this could be a three-dimensional cone, okay. You have accumulation of wavefront. The wavefront is always has always the same value here. You see, all these wavefronts are tangential to this this line. So this is like a plane wave, in fact, moving that way and that one moving this way, perpendicularly to the wavefront. So important point here is this, this is a plane wave generated, and this is called the shock wave. These two plane waves propagating are called the shock wave. So you have the same intensity along all the that plane. Let's now introduce the Mach number. So you probably know that the Mach number is the ratio speed of the source divided by speed of sound. So it is how much faster your source is moving compared to the sound. So for planes, let's say Mach 2.3, this would mean that the plane is going 2.3 times the speed of sound. All right. So how? Okay. So what is this Mach? How to calculate this Mach number? So, in fact, what we are looking at is you see that this. Theta here is defining the cone, okay, because it is the angle between the two. No, two theta is the angle between the two plane waves here. So theta is the definition, defines the cone. So let's find out this theta. So here, let's take for example this triangle. This one, so there is a rectangle here. Yes, this rectangular triangle. Okay, let's take the sine. So sine theta is opposite, so it is this one. And this is how far the wavefront emitted when the source was as at S1 has traveled. So this is Vt, speed of sound by time. The source now is here after time t. So the source has traveled a distance Vst. Okay, S is for source. So we just have Vt divided by Vst. So t disappears, we have V divided by Vs. Okay, which is V divided by Vs is the inverse of the Mach number. Okay, so your Mach number is in fact 1 divided by sin theta. Let's look at some examples of supersonic speeds and shock waves. So you probably know that, okay. All fighter jets, many fighter jets can go faster than the speed of sound. For commercial aircraft, there was a Concorde. We'll come back to that soon. So this is a so-called a Mach cone, actually, seen here. So this is made of steam, of water vapor. So why do they form? It's just thermodynamic. So this happens roughly in this cone. Let me change to the pen. No, to the pen. Right. So in fact, here you have a huge pressure. Here you have a huge pressure. So it's a plane wave. So you have, let's say, a sine wave. Okay. And so this is a place where you have the huge pressures. But in between, you have huge depression, low pressure. So here you have extremely low pressures. And when you have a low pressure in the air, the temperature goes down, and then you can the water mist can form, right? So water make a transition between gas to droplets. Right. So this is again the same picture. This is an example with a bullet, actually. So a bullet that was fired into a fluid. And so we could observe the... this is that shockwave. So you have several wave fronts because it all depends on the shape of the object traveling. So you can look at that at this site. Another example is the low boom flight. So this has to do with commercial flights. So as you know, the Concorde was a supersonic plane. And nowadays, people are thinking again about building some supersonic planes. And the problem is, if you go faster than sound, you will always have a sonic boom following your flight. So if you fly over a populated area, you will have they will hear the boom. So now there is some research to make this boom as low as possible. And okay, you may watch these videos on YouTube about this. So I don't show you them here because the music is copyrighted in these videos. So I don't want to have copyright problems. Let's finish this lecture with some applications of Doppler effect. For example, it is used to find out distances with radars, sonars, underwater. You know also, you have probably heard about the redshift in astronomy, showing that galaxies are going away from each other. Medical imaging, like the echocardiogram. Also less known maybe is the temperature measurement using the Doppler effect of electromagnetic waves and the motion of particles which is connected to the temperature. So there are others, of course, many other applications. Here, let's finish with the formula summary. So here are all the formulas you should know. The concept of intensity, which is the total emitted power divided by the area perpendicular to the flow. And for a point source, because the emission is isotropic, your surface is of course the surface of a sphere. The sound decibel scale. And the Doppler formula. So of course you should know how to set the proper signs here. And be careful of the wind, so it will modify, if there is wind, it would modify the detector and source speeds. And of course, you should know everything about the Mach cone angle, how to derive this equation, etc.